Today, we're celebrating Women's History Month with four fabulous ambassadors, Caribbean women who are moving and shaking and doing great things here in Washington, D.C. We're laughing and chatting and smiling and reflecting and discussing everything under the sun. It's a lime. So sit back and relax and let's have fun. My name is Monique Marie McSween, and welcome to My Living Room Lime. Today, we're celebrating Women's History Month with four fabulous ambassadors. We're laughing and chatting and smiling and reflecting and discussing everything under the sun. Let's start our line with introducing our ambassadors. Ambassador Nirmala Badrasingh is the Ambassador of Suriname to the United States and Permanent Representative of Suriname to the Organization of American States. Before coming to Washington, D.C., Ambassador Badrasingh served as the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Suriname. Ambassador Yolande Yvonne Smith is the Ambassador of Grenada to the United States and Permanent Representative of Grenada to the Organization of American States. Prior to coming to D.C., Ambassador Smith served as Deputy Consul General at the Consulate General of Grenada in Miami from 2015 to 2018. Ambassador Jacinth Henry Martin is Coordinator of the Coordinating Office for the Offices and Units of the General Secretariat at the Organization of American States. Before joining the OAS in this capacity, Ambassador Henry Martin served as Ambassador of St. Kitts and Nevis to the United States and Permanent Representative of St. Kitts and Nevis to the Organization of American States. Ambassador Lacelia Prince is Chief of Staff at the Office of the Assistant Secretary General of the Organization of American States. Before joining the OAS in this capacity, Ambassador Prince served as the Ambassador of St. Vincent and the Grenadines to the United States and Permanent Representative of St. Vincent and the Grenadines to the Organization of American States. Welcome, ambassadors. Are you ready to lime?
We definitely are.
All right. So let's launch our lime with what I call our big question about who we are as a community of women. And I'd like to start with you, Ambassador Smith. As women, we often define our value, our self-worth, by our capacity to do and have it all. But we all know that we can't do it and have it all, or maybe we can. You tell us, do you really think that as women, we can do and have it all?
I don't know. I think, thank you very much, Monique, for having me on the line, and I'm in good company, so I'm really excited about, you know, how this is gonna turn out. But I think we put added pressure on ourselves as women, or saying that we can have it all. And what does all mean? If all means the husband, the corner office, the children, and so, if it is something that you desire and it is your goal and you can put everything into it to achieve it, then that is success by your standards and you can have it all. But I'm not even sure if I want to have it all. I want to have a certain measure of success that I'm comfortable with and saying that I was able to at least inspire or to help someone. Because having it all and sacrificing something else for it, I don't know that it is worth the where we're placed into the, oh, she needs to have it all, or we want to have it all. I prefer to have a certain measure of success than have it all if having it all means I left something else on the table.
Let's talk about that measure of success, because more and more today, we as women, as we speak about doing and having and being it all, we are really elevating to positions of leadership. You yourself, together with your fellow ambassadors, you are representing your country in major international fora here in Washington, D.C. and around the world. And so that's, as we speak about the measure of success, that leads me to my next question. Do you think that men or woman, or put another way, do you think that women have a unique value proposition, that we women have a unique value proposition that make us better leaders than men? Ambassador Badri Singh, what do you think about that?
I think it's a tricky question, Monique, but let me start by also thanking you for giving all of us this opportunity to have a Saturday afternoon live and to have fun while we are discussing how we can further the equality and the empowerment of women. You know, I do not believe that men are better leaders than women. Okay, to start with. Because what are we looking for? How do you measure the success of leadership? I think at the end of the day, if it comes to, for instance, leadership in the private sector, then people would say, how much profit do you make at the end of the year to demonstrate that as a leader in the private sector, you have been successful? I do believe that women can do the same thing. I mean, if you are well-educated, you know how you can lead the business, you can be equally successful as a man. When you talk about politics, it's a different ballgame. When you talk about diplomacy, it's something else as well. But I do think that women have certain values that adds value. I think through my life, I've noticed that quite often the strength of our intuition and our ability to look at things from a bird's eye view helps you to be a more sensitive leader. And of course, the context differs always. You have to look at the success within the context of the audience you are trying to deal with. If you are, for instance, with a group of politicians discussing a certain matter, quite often the level of success of your leadership comes when you know that the decision that results out of it, if it is something that has a larger ownership of everybody and it is implementable, then you know that that can be successful. But I do not necessarily think that women are better or men are better in terms of the leadership. It is what components do you bring into it? How sensitive are you to a specific situation? How sensitive are you to the audience that you are dealing with?
Over and over again, you mentioned sensitivity and emotional intelligence and instinct and intuition. And so that is a great segue to my next question, which is for Ambassador Prince. Let's talk about that a bit, because as we speak about emotion, you know, we successful women, and I am just so proud to be and honored to be in this space with the four of you today. When we lean in, when we go after what we want, right, we are called aggressive. But when men go after what they want, people refer to them as, you know, he's the boss. I mean, he's great. How do you respond to that?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for having me, Monique. It's an honor to be here with these fabulous ladies, all of whom I've worked with before. So this feels like a wonderful reunion. To respond to that question, yes, you are correct. I've seen that in the professional sphere, not just with myself, but other women as well. The men are described as leaders. They're assertive. And the woman is described as bossy or less complimentary adjectives. For that, I have no apology. I'm willing to learn as I go along professionally, but I have no apology for being confident and decisive once I know that I am being a leader that exemplifies what leadership should be. I have a little girl, I have a girl and a boy, and my little girl is very self-assured, very confident. And I always say that I hope she would be twice the person that I am, or even more, because I don't feel that women should have to hide their talent under a bushel.
Ambassador, you are obviously injecting and infusing that self-confidence and that sense of esteem and self-worth in your daughter on a day-to-day basis. But there are some women who don't have that or did not receive that sort of self-assurance at home. And so being in a community of women is very important. And so my next question is to Ambassador Henry Martin. You as a diplomat, you're in a male-dominated environment, right? In the field of diplomacy and politics and government. What do you do on a daily basis to support your colleagues, not just the ambassadors here in this line, but your community of women to ensure that you strengthen and bolster those around you?
I've heard the expression male-dominated very often. I like to think of it more as male abundant, because I don't know that they dominate, and I have nothing against men. I have 3 sons and I want to empower them to be gentlemen and to be leaders in their own right. But sometimes, yes, we are in environments that are male abundant. I served as a minister and elected parliamentarian, and I was the only female in the cabinet at the time. I was not daunted by the fact that I contested the seat against the then sitting leader of the opposition. And it is because I feel as if you are going to do something, you do it well, you do it with all of the power that you bring to bear in asserting your right to be there. And so my advice to my sisters would be on top of your game, given an opportunity to shine. Don't hide your light. Enter the opportunity with the same aplomb and with the same fierceness, if you will, and with the same power behind your capacity and your ability as your male colleagues. If you are good at something, it should not be defined by the sex that you are. And so a woman who is good at what she does is as significant in the role that she's called upon to play as the man who is good at what he does. And that would be my advice. Be your best self professionally and personally at every opportunity, and you will shine.
Thank you, Ambassador Henry Martin. That is just such powerful, powerful advice. Ambassador Smith, how has being raised in the Caribbean, on an island, how has that, by Caribbean parents or Caribbean guardians, how has that impacted your outlook on leadership and on life?
Well, I was raised Grenadian, and I was raised in a multi-generational household with my grandmother, my mom, 2 aunts, and my siblings. It was a 1-bedroom wooden house. It was spotless. We slept on the floor. We rolled up our beds in the morning. But I think what I learned from those ladies, and if that was a measure of poverty or definition of poverty, I never knew I was poor, because we had love in the household. We always had laughter and fun. My grandmother was a comedian and my mom was a very funny woman as well. But I think what I learned from them more than anything else, and I take that with me in whatever role I am in, is the tenacity and the audacity, if I should borrow President Barack Obama's words, the audacity to go beyond where their circumstances had them. They were fearless, they were formidable, they knew how to budget, they knew how to make ends meet. And of course, our Caribbean-ness has a certain amount of charm in it as well. So I feel I have used that to defuse situations in negotiating when things could be contentious. I've used my charm and my wit and my comedy to sort of diffuse that. But I think if nothing else, these women are leaders, because we tend to think that leadership is in the boardrooms or the halls of diplomacy. But as women raising themselves out of poverty, raising themselves out of abusive households to give their children an education that they did not have. But, you know, I was able to take that and I carry that with me, and I see these women as role models. So I feel I've had built-in role models all my life growing up. And if I don't take that away, then I think I would have lost an opportunity to be in a loving household that just, you know, gave me everything that I have today. And it may seem very glamorous and prestigious, but at the end of the day, is that the morals and the core, you know, values that I got being raised in a loving household. I think I take that with me wherever I go in whatever field.
Ambassador Smith, you know, you so beautifully encapsulated everything that is Caribbean, our audacity, our love for life, the way we enjoy life, our sense of humor that we learned growing up in the Caribbean. Ambassador Prince, I would love for you just to share with us some of the values that you learned, that you think that you have applied to your career, which has definitely led to your success today.
For me, growing up, like Ambassador Smith, I grew up in an environment where women were at the forefront. My mother is a woman with a very strong personality, major influence on my life. I saw that as well at church, women in church. I went to an all-girls school. And so I grew up always feeling empowered, always feeling that I can achieve, always understanding the value of hard work and education. I'm not from a rich family, but we understood that you work hard and you get the rewards. Once there is opportunity, you create opportunity for yourself. Also in my country, I don't know for my colleagues how it was, but even though we have rich and poor, you know, you have the different classes, I did not feel the stratification that you're exposed to when I grew up and went to live in different countries. So I always had embedded in me the knowledge and the confidence that once I used my education, honesty, determination, that I could succeed. So that is, those are some of the values that I've carried with me, but also just the importance of treating people with respect, because it's a virtuous cycle. It comes back to you. Manners, that's something that, I mean, even if we didn't want to be polite, I'm from the Caribbean, as we all are, and our parents would make sure that we, you know, show good manners. And that I think is important. You know, I see in different societies that I've lived in where there is this level of stratification that you reserve a certain level of treatment for one person that is perceived to be powerful or wealthy, and then a different treatment for others. And that's not how I was raised. And so those are values that I take with me throughout life. And I think that the rewards have come back to me. I will greet in the same way an ambassador as I would greet a custodian in a building. And those are the values I plan to inculcate, or I'm trying to inculcate, in my children. And so I think that those are fundamental to my being, and people appreciate that.
Thank you, Ambassador. You know, as you spoke about your Caribbean womanhood and being raised by strong Caribbean women, I know that there are certain things that we learned. You spoke about you had to be polite, you had to be respectful. Ambassador Badri Singh, tell us, I know that you learned certain things from the woman in your life as you were growing up. What are three things you think every woman should own?
I like that question. First of all, a beautiful pearl, a strand of pearls, okay?
Agreed.
Second, and I think all the women up there can attest to that, tight-fitting leather skirt or pant.
No argument from me there, agreed.
And I would definitely say a pair of pumps with stiletto heels. That's it.
That sounds like all of the essentials right there.
It's also a message that despite our achievements in our professional life, we are still women and we are very feminine and we like to look fabulous and nice. And it's also up to us to wear those nice, beautiful things.
Ambassador Henry Martin, I would love for you to share some of your insights on what should every woman know before they make a serious commitment to a partner. Serious commitment meaning marriage. So what do you think we should know before we jump into a serious relationship?
I'm going to tell you the ones I can say on this line. Let's keep it at that. But number one is going to have to be his true personality. I think that usually shows up not always, but primarily when he gets angry. So the first one is going to be the true personality of the person. You know, when you're dating, you see the personality they want you to see. And so the true personality is one that you have to become very familiar with, because that's not what somebody you want to meet after you have committed. The next one is going to have to be, you want to know what his significant goals are. What would he like to achieve in his life? What, you know, you want to get an insight into his ambition. And the last thing I think you want to really know, and these are the ones I can mention, would be his capacity not only to love, but to forgive. Because when you are in a relationship, it's not all hunky-dory and it's not always a bed of roses. Sometimes there are occasions when you want to be able to say, you did that, but I forgive you. And if this person that you're willing to commit to is unable to do that in any way, in any capacity, he has no room for that in his heart, then that's somebody who you probably want to have second and third thoughts about. We won't go into number four and number five, but we'll stick with those three.
Well, Ambassador, with those three, I'm not sure if you have a side hustle as a relationship counselor, but I encourage you to write a book, because a lot of people can do with that advice right now. And, you know, I myself grew up with so many lessons that my mother and grandmother and aunts taught me. Those old Caribbean sayings like only curtain knows what behind door. And so I know, you know, as we wrap up this Living Room Lime, I would love for you to share with your viewers, or with our viewers rather, what are those things that you wish you had listened to? Those bits of advice that growing up as a teenager, when you experience heartbreak or loss or any sadness or even low self-esteem, what are those bits of advice that the woman in your life shared with you that you wish you had listened to? And I'm opening this up to the floor as we wrap up our Living Room Line.
I wish that someone had said to me in so many words, and this is the message I want to give to women as well, that you are enough and that you have to learn to trust your gut. There is, especially for us and all women, but we're speaking to melanated folks here. You know, there is someone who lives inside of all of us who longs to be your best friend. I refer to my person as the Black woman in me, and she has a name. Her name is Jazz Jazz. And I like to listen to Jazz Jazz because she's never really led me wrong. And so what I would like to say, and something that I wish is that had been instilled in me, maybe as a child, because as you grow up, you learn. But it would be nice if all of our daughters, especially, were to learn that you are a great person. You are enough. You can conquer the world. And you don't need a hammer to kill an ant. I'm sorry, you don't need a hammer to kill an ant. You can be yourself. You can be loving. You can be kind. And when it requires you to be audacious, and when it requires you to speak a little louder, then you do that. Right. That your gut will not fail you. Listen to everything and all of the advice that is going to come your way, but ultimately, you make the call about particular solid decision that you have to make. You make that call based on what the Black woman in you is telling you is good for you.
Thank you.
In my case, I think I wish that I had listened more to those around me. I was fortunate to grow up in an environment which was always positively reinforcing. At home, as I said before, at home, at church, at school, my environment generally. And people always believed in me, but for some reason, I didn't believe in myself. I was clouded in self-doubt. and very competitive and always feeling as though there is always going to be somebody much better than me and that I am not good enough. I'm not getting 100%. I wish I had listened more to the encouragement around me. It would have saved me a lot of the agony that I went through doubting myself. I spent a lot of time doubting myself. Eventually, I was able to emerge from that, not fully. I still have growth. I have space for growth. But really, I think when we have people around us that encourage us, we should take a cue from them. We should stop and listen and reflect on ourselves and to see what they are seeing in us. Why am I not seeing in myself what others are seeing in me?
Thank you.
I don't know if I can jump in here. My mom always said to me, you know, you're not superwoman. Sometimes we have that notion that we have to be everything for everybody every time. So I think for me, I learned that over the years, self-care. And self-care is not a manicure and a pedicure. Sometimes it's saying no or just taking time, even from your family, from, you know, just taking time for yourself to breathe and to resuscitate yourself, because sometimes we feel, especially in the environment that we all four are in, and yours as well, which is a very busy lifestyle, hectic with a lot going on, we tend to want to be everything for everybody, because if we say no, then it diminishes, you know, us in the eyes of somebody else. But sometimes we have to put ourselves first in order to be all that we can be for somebody. And sometimes it is saying no. That I wish I'd learned earlier. Being able to say no, I can't do this, or I can't do it now. Yeah.
I come from one of the most diverse countries in the region, where Indian women, or I should say Surinamese from Indian descent, and women like me, I'm the third generation of Indians in Suriname. We had to work very, very hard, not only from an educational perspective, but also from the perspective of gaining the rightful place in the executive or in the judiciary or whatever position, high position in the country. My mom always was always telling me, remember, you are as good as you think you are. Believe in yourself. Be curious about what is happening around you. Watch what is happening around you. Learn a lesson from the mistakes that you make. Share that with others. And she would always say, be compassionate about everything you do. Excel in everything you do. You will make mistakes, but there is no time to cry about it. Basically, she would tell you, go take your big girl's panty out of the closet, wear it, and move ahead.
Thank you so much, ambassadors. This has been such a wonderful Caribbean moment for us. And just know that what you have shared this afternoon has lifted me, it's lifted my spirits. I'm sure we've lifted each other. But as we spread this word, not just in the Caribbean and around the United States and around the world, you really would have brightened the day of so many people. Thank you so much for all that you have shared this afternoon. I'm honored to have you in my living room, Lime. I enjoyed liming with you, and I know that our viewers did too. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, ladies.
This is Monique Marie McSween. I hope you've enjoyed My Living Room Lime. Stay tuned for the next episode of My Living Room Lime on Carib Nation TV.